We are going through this interesting book written 2,500 years ago. All of us patiently awaiting those portions which come later that are perhaps a bigger pressure point for us. We're in the middle of the book almost, in those passages which focus primarily on the impending judgment on Jerusalem. We find ourselves sensitive on the one hand to Ezekiel's unique historical situation, being trained as a priest, but called to the office of a prophet at a time in Israel's history in which they're partially in captivity. Ezekiel and his friends are, of course, in Babylon as captives, but Ezekiel preaching to those that are still in Jerusalem, those that feel that their troubles are temporary, those that don't really perceive the inevitability of God's coming judgment on them, those that do not hear his call for repentance. We find that Ezekiel's indulging in all kinds of questions they called upon to do all kinds of play acting and object lessons and skits or charades or what have you to get across to the observers, his hearers, or I should say would-be hearers, that God is serious, that the armies of Nebuchadnezzar, while they are pagan, idol-worshipping nations, they're being used by God to bring his judgment upon his nation, Israel, who has not seen nor heard what God would have them do. So on the one hand, it's an ancient area. It's an area of Scripture that deals with a time long gone by. And yet, as we go through these chapters, we might do well to recognize that there's applicability to you and I today. These passages focus on people who hear but don't hear God's call, don't perceive God's message of a coming judgment. And so while we go through, we're really going through a portion of the book of Ezekiel for which we're probably just trying to maybe glean some background on Jerusalem and what it was like just prior to and during the Babylonian captivity. On the one hand, we're going through this background as a prelude to those portions of Scripture which we might feel are more relevant for us today, the famous incursion of Ezekiel 38 and 9, that we, 38, no, chapters 38 and 39, which are so perhaps relevant to us. Chapters 34 on, which describe the call of Israel back to the land that we're so vividly witnessing in our recent era. But we should, as we go here, recognize that God is using Ezekiel not just to talk to those of Judah. I'm going to suggest the possibility that he may be here through the Holy Spirit talking to we ourselves in terms of the idols that we worship, the false prophets that compete for our ear, the kind of messages that we might find more comfortable than those that God has for us. So we're going to find the next several chapters of that flavor. I believe last time we got through the end of chapter 11, and so we're tonight jumping into chapter 12. Chapter 12, verse 1, "The word of the Lord also came unto me, saying, Son of man, thou dwellest in the midst of a rebellious house. Who have eyes to see and see not? And they have ears to hear and hear not, for they are a rebellious house." Now, we could, of course, go back and we'll discover that there are many passages in the Old Testament that deal with this issue, that the would-be hearer of God's word hears but doesn't hear, sees but doesn't see. And that would take us into places like Deuteronomy 29, the first four verses. It would take us into Isaiah 6, verses 9 through 10, Jeremiah 5, verse 21. But let's take, for us, a New Testament passage of an equivalent shape. Let's turn to Matthew 13. If you recall, in Matthew 13, it's a famous chapter because it deals with what we sometimes call the seven kingdom parables. For those of you that have studied this chapter, we may recall that the first parable was the sower that sows seed on four different kinds of soils. And he tells that interesting parable. And then later on in the chapter, he explains that that the seed is the word of God, the four soils are four different kinds of hearts. In some cases,
doesn't bear fruit. Some cases it does in different amounts. And he describes these different conditions under which we use this example of the sower and the seed. And then the second parable is the same kind of a model, a sower sowing seed, but then an enemy comes at night and sows tares, or what we might call weeds. And they grow up together. And again, we have the field being the world. We have the sower being the Son of God, the seed being the Word. And this enemy that comes, of course, being Satan, what have you. Those two parables he explains later. And they're followed by five others. The mustard seed that grows to be a tree. And he has the pearl of a great price and so forth. And those parables are the later ones are very peculiar because they're real meaning is not what it would seem. We're often frustrated that he actually only explains the first two. It's the other ones that give us some of the real problems. Those of you that have not studied the Seven Kingdom Parables, I commend to you either a tape on Matthew 13 or alternatively study the seven letters to seven churches in Revelation chapters 2 and 3. Because we're startled to discover that the seven parables that the Lord gives the seven disciples parallel in a remarkable way the seven letters that the Lord dictates to John later in the book of Revelation. And the spiritual models of those seven churches parallel these seven parables, and it even goes on to the epistles of Paul. Those of you that have been there, you're in for some real surprises if you haven't been into this. But my motive here is not to get into Matthew 13 per se, but to point out something, because the disciples in chapter 13, verse 10, ask him a question. Why do you speak in parables? Now, we often talk about that the parables are clever little instruments for us to learn, and often they are. They're explanatory analogies that make something complicated very simple and clear. And often the parables have that role. In this chapter, some of the parables almost are cryptic or riddles or mysteries. Anyway, verse 10, they ask him, why do you speak in parables? And he answers that in the following verses. He answered and said unto them, verse 11, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. For whosoever he hath, to him it shall be given, to, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken away even that which he hath. What is he talking about in verse 12? Ooh, well, that's your assignment for this week to figure that out. You know? Some people would argue it's the Holy Spirit, or that which has a little insight gets more, and so forth. But let's move on to verse 13, because that really focuses right in. I'm interested in verses 13 through 15, because the Lord here says, therefore speak I to them in parables, because they seeing see not, and hearing they hear not, neither do they understand. For in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, by hearing ye shall hear and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see and not perceive. For this people's heart is become gross, their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes they have closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes or hear with their ears, and should understand with their heart, and should be converted, and I should heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. Okay, for verily I say unto you that many prophets and righteous men have desired to see those things which ye see, and have not seen them, to hear those things which ye hear, and have not heard them. Hear therefore the parable of the sower. Then he goes on to explain one of these parables. And there's a whole thing we could get into here, but I will forego that. But anyway, he's quoting here from Isaiah 6, verses 9 and 10. And you can also, if you like, compare this with John 12 and some other things. Anyway, this whole idea we see all through the Scripture, New Testament too. We could go to Mark 8, 18, John chapter 12, verses 39 to 40, and Acts 28, verses 26 and 27, to find similar examples in the New Testament where God is... I started to use the term frustrated. I'm sure God can't be frustrated in the sense that you and I might use the term. But he certainly must be, his patience must be certainly tried, let me phrase it that way, with those that should hear his message and yet don't. The incredible lengths he'll go through to get our attention and yet never violate our sovereignty. And that's really what we see again and again in the history of Israel. And yet, there again, we shouldn't just dismiss that. Well, that was that obstinate ancient people. I was amused one night, many years ago. It was one of those times when on national television they reran the Cecil B. DeMille film, The Ten Commandments, which, with whatever its faults, is still quite a piece of work, especially the time it was written or presented or put together. Some friends of ours who are not really Christians and yet sort of somewhat biblically aware, were watching it, and they made the remark to us, the thing that they could not get over, you know, that scene, here the nation of slaves are delivered by all these incredible, dramatic plagues, and they're not out in the desert but any time at all when they're building the golden calf and yearning to go back. They couldn't get over of how this nation, with its visible, the visible intervention of God himself in their history, could so quickly sort of dismiss that, shrug it off, and want to go back to Egypt as slaves. They remarked at how phenomenal that was. And yet how interesting it is that as we look at our own lives and realize that God has, even in more dramatic ways than for them, intervened in our lives. And I say our lives in the Christian era, in terms of Jesus Christ having walked this earth, made such an impact that we, every time we write the date on our check, we should be reminded of the man by whom time is reckoned. And raising from the dead, and the whole phenomenal involvement of God in our history is no less visible, in fact, perhaps with even a more awesome sweep of history than that one episode so vividly chronicles. And yet, do we hear? Do we really see? I suppose we, by very being here tonight, if not having heard something, at least have an openness to hear it. But as we read this, I'd like to really somehow put ourselves in the place of Israel and try to give ourselves some kind of assurance that we're not falling into the same trap they did in terms of their deafness and their blindness spiritually. I mean, we got down to verse 3, I guess, before I charged off. Sorry about that. But that's sort of the reason I dwell on a little bit. That's the theme of the next several chapters. And we're going to see Ezekiel continually be God's way of, so to speak, holding himself blameless. In other words, having gone the extra mile, knowing that their hearts were hardened, that they wouldn't hear, but using Ezekiel here as a mechanism to prove that he is righteous when he judges them. Verse 3, therefore, son of man, prepare thee baggage for removing, and move by day in their sight. And now what Ezekiel's about to do, as we read here, what he's going to do is he's going to act out sort of a pantomime or a charade or a skit. He's actually going to do something sort of in his neighborhood, but in sort of a public way, and apparently done in a context that they know that he's acting out a message. We've seen Ezekiel do that several times, where he had to lay on one side for so many days and this sort of thing, where he made himself a little sandbox kind of skit where he had a pan and a wall, and you know, he did all this so that those that were watching him could tell that he used this as sort of the Sesame Street of Old Testament prophecy, sort of a way to get across to these people that God was trying to get something, the message to them. Well, he's going to go through an act here, so recognize what God asked him to do. Therefore, son of man, prepare thee baggage for removing. Now, that's an old English term for what we would call like a relocation, like a move, like you're going to go from change your address, okay? And move by day in their sight, and thou shalt move from thy place to another place in their sight. It may be they will consider, though they are a rebellious house. Verse 4. Then shalt thou bring forth thy baggage by day in their sight as baggage for removing, and thou shalt go forth at evening in their sight as they go forth into captivity. In other words, this was symbolic to indicate they were going to be fleeing the city to try to avoid capture, subsequently to be, of course, captured and made slaves. But he's trying to get them separated from their complacency. Yes, they know that there was a deportation, and yes, the city is under vassal rule, but they sort of have this attitude that it's just temporary, things are going to get better, and they're not listening to the prophets, both Jeremiah earlier, Ezekiel now, that, hey, this is serious, it's a 70-year captivity, and recognize that while they are God's enemies, the enemies of the chosen people, they are God's instrument in bringing forth judgment. That's going to be the message forthcoming. Now, he says something interesting in verse 5. He says, dig through the wall in their sight and carry out through it. In other words, don't leave through the gate. So he's trying to create, by analogy or simile or whatever, he's acting out the idea that he's pretending to escape. He's digging under the wall and carrying this baggage with him. Now, it isn't necessarily the wall of the city. It might be just, we don't know exactly. It's probably just the wall of the patio place that he was in. But he digs under the wall, goes through this whole routine. And they must have been standing around puzzled. What is this guy doing? And I think they're probably used to him by now, that this was his way of getting across, sort of like a riddle. And what's the motto here? Dig through the wall in their sight and carry out through it. In their sight shalt thou bear it upon... See, now, he's not really sneaking away, or he wouldn't be doing it in their sight. You with me? But he's sort of acting out like sneaking away. So they understand that that's their destiny. They're going to be fleeing. They're going to be trying to escape. In their sight shalt thou bear it upon thy shoulders and carry it forth. In the twilight thou shalt cover thy face, that thou see not the ground. For I have set thee as a sign unto the house of Israel. And I did so, Ezekiel talking, as I was commanded. I brought forth my baggage by day as baggage for captivity. And in the evening I dig through the wall with my hand. I brought it forth in the twilight, and I bore it upon my shoulder in their sight. And in the morning came the word of the Lord unto me, saying, Son of man, hath not the house of Israel, the rebellious house, said unto thee, What doest thou? Say thou unto them. In other words, this is the explanation now. Okay. Thus saith the Lord God, This burden cometh the prince of Jerusalem and all the house of Israel that are among them. Now, by the way, one small comment. Who is the prince of Jerusalem? Turns out that's Zedekiah. And one subtlety here that's probably worth mentioning is that Jehoiakim was replaced by the Babylonians after that first rebellion by Zedekiah. And it's Zedekiah's ultimate rebellion that brings the house down around his ears. Okay? But Zedekiah is never called by, in a superficial description of this, we say Jehoiakim was the king until, a vassal king after that first captivity, and he was displaced, and Zedekiah was put on the throne, and then Zedekiah subsequently rebels, and that's when, you know, the whole thing comes to a screeching halt here, and the city's leveled, and all of them are finally taken into captivity, just as Ezekiel was earlier. But the point is, Zedekiah, a subtlety here, Zedekiah is never called a king by Ezekiel. He's always called the prince, never king. The reason is Jehoiakim is the true king, and we'll discover in chapter 17, verse 13, that point will be brought home. Because the Babylonians never officially deposed him. They just replaced another minion, if you will, namely Zedekiah. I think it was his uncle, if I recall correctly, on the throne to be their deputy, if you will. In fact, if you compare the, you'll discover that Jehoiakim was, if you look at 2 Kings 25, just as a small point, but to show you that you can get rewarded for some homework here. 2 Kings chapter 25, which is the last chapter in 2 Kings. The last four verses say, It came to pass in the 7th and 30th year of the captivity of Jehoiachin, the king of Judah, in the 12th month, in the 7th and 20th day of the month, that Evil-Merodach, the king of Babylon, in the year that he began to reign, did liberate Jehoiachin, the king of Judah, from prison. And he spoke kindly to him and set his throne above the throne of the kings that were with him in Babylon, changed his prison garments, and he did eat his food regularly before him all the days of his life, and his allowance was a regular allowance given to him by the king, a daily rate for every day, all the days of his life. Now, if you notice here, this was in the 7th and 30th year of the captivity. If you remember the first two verses of the book of Ezekiel, verse 2, in fact, it says that in the 5th day of the month, which was the 5th year of Jehoiachin's activity, that Ezekiel was. So Ezekiel was deported in the 5th year, and Jehoiachin is released from prison and on a ration, if you will, on the 37th year. Okay? So we've got, what do we have there? We've got some 32 years of him being in exile, being in prison. During this time, his uncle is deputized, Zedekiah. I think it's his uncle. I've forgotten to do that homework. But anyway, check my notes. But anyway, Zedekiah is established on the throne. Zedekiah rebels. He gets put down. And that's, you know, Jerusalem's going to fall. That's going to happen about chapter 33, as I recall. We're going to get to, in this chapter, a little more about how Zedekiah's destiny. Excuse me, in verse 10, it speaks of the prince of Jerusalem. He's speaking here of Zedekiah, I believe. And all the house of Israel that are among them. But verse 11, say, I am your sign. This is what God is telling Ezekiel to answer them when they ask him, what's this, all this peculiar conduct supposed to mean? He says, I am your sign, as I have done, so shall it be done unto them. They shall move and go into captivity. And the prince that is among them shall bear upon his shoulder in twilight, and shall go forth. They shall dig through the wall to carry out through it. He shall cover his face, that he see not the ground with his eyes. My net also will I spread upon him, and he shall be taken in my snare. And I will bring him to Babylon, to the land of the Chaldeans. Yet shall he not see it, though he shall die there. And I will scatter toward every wind all that are about him to help him, and all his bands, and I will draw out the sword after them, and they shall know that I am the Lord. There's that phrase again that echoes all through the book of Ezekiel, and they shall know that I am the Lord. When I shall scatter them among the nations and disperse them in the countries, I shall leave a few men of them from the sword, from the famine, from the pestilence, that they may declare all their abominations among the nations to which they come, and they shall know that I am the Lord. Again, that echo. Now, this leads, of course, to some interesting passages that I think might be worth just taking a quick peek at. You might turn with me to Jeremiah 39. Well, let's see. Probably the interesting one is 2 Kings 25. We looked at the last four verses of that chapter. I'd now like you to take a look at maybe, something like the first seven verses. 2 Kings 25, verse 1, it came to pass the ninth year of his reign, in the tenth month, and the tenth day of the month, that Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, came, he and all his host, against Jerusalem, and camped against it, and they built forts against it round about. And the city was besieged unto the 11th year of King Zedekiah. Now here, see, the chronicler, the writer of 2 Kings, calls him King Zedekiah. You'll hear that phrase, King Zedekiah. It's Ezekiel that never conveys that title. He always calls him a prince. He refuses to call him really king. Ezekiel is being more precise, more technical, in a more accurate sense. Verse 3, and on the ninth day of the fourth month, the famine prevailed in the city, and there was no bread for the people of the land. Now, by the way, before I go on, I should mention, I meant to grab from my library, and I forgot to, a copy of Josephus. Those of you that have access to a copy of Josephus, his book called, the work called Antiquities. Those of you that haven't, make note of Roman numeral 10, section 7, verse 2. And you'll discover Josephus describes the circumstances surrounding Jeremiah and Ezekiel. Zedekiah made fun of both of them because Jeremiah comments on Jeremiah's preaching against Zedekiah, and so much so that Zedekiah throws him in prison. Ezekiel also. But Zedekiah makes fun of them because with respect to other prophecies, they agreed, and those prophecies happened. Apparently, Zedekiah perceived contradictions in the prophecies of Jeremiah, who predicted that Zedekiah was going to go off to Babylon, and Ezekiel, who said that he would never see the Babylonian captivity. And Josephus calls attention to, in effect, that conflict. And, of course, the resolution of that is here chronicled in 2 Kings, verses 4 through 7. And the city was broken up, and all the men of war fled by night, by the way of the gate between the two walls, which is by the king's garden. Now the Chaldeans were against the city roundabout. And the king went the way toward Arabah. And the army of the Chaldeans pursued the king, overtook him in the plains of Jericho. And all his army were scattered from him. So they took the king and brought him up to the king of Babylon at Riblah, and they pronounced sentence upon him. And here is the heavy verse, 2 Kings 25:7. And they slew the sons of Zedekiah before his eyes, and put out the eyes of Zedekiah, and bound him with fetters of bronze, and carried him to Babylon. So Zedekiah, because of his rebellion against Nebuchadnezzar, is brought to Riblah. His sons are executed before his eyes, and then he's blinded. Partly as punishment, and partly to make sure he would never rule again. And they bound him, of course, in fetters of bronze and carried him off to Babylon. Now, the irony of that, of course, is not lost upon us as we return to Ezekiel's prophecy in verse 13, where Ezekiel forecasts that he, speaking of that, I will bring him to Babylon, or I should say that God instructs Ezekiel to announce that I will bring him to Babylon, to the land of the Chaldeans, yet shall he not see it, though he shall die there. Very grim, somber irony here. Zedekiah died where? In Babylon. Did he ever see Babylon? No. This is one of those places where, and I don't mean to sound flippant or cute, it's you've got to read the fine print in these prophecies. God is literal. Now, here it's sort of with a somber grimness. But you'll also discover the more you study prophecy, when Daniel read Jeremiah, and just spoke of the 70 years captivity, Daniel took Jeremiah literally, not allegorically or figuratively. Every time Jesus quotes from the Old Testament, he quotes literally. Every time you see the word of God applied by another servant of God in the scripture, you'll notice that it's always literal. And therein is the ammunition for those that do take the Bible literally. When you come across prophecies like this, it's not only literal, it's literal to a precision that makes you almost squirm. So, God doesn't mess around where his word is going. Not one jot or one tittle shall pass from the law until all be fulfilled. Okay. Okay, I guess that brings us down to about verse 16. You'll notice here we have a sword, famine, and pestilence. We're going to talk about that a little later. So let's just make note of it and go on. Verse 17, moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, eat thy bread with quaking, and drink thy water with trembling and with anxiety. And say it, presumably here, the context is that he's doing this conspicuously. He's not saying, you know, eat your bread with quaking privately. He's saying, make a conspicuous public show that as you eat your bread, you're trembling, okay? And drinking your water with anxiety. Ezekiel is called upon here, I believe, that's just my view of this passage, just as he did before. It's another play acting, another skit, another demonstration, if you will, of sorts, to get across. It's an object lesson thing, okay? In verse 19, and say unto the people of the land, thus saith the Lord God, the inhabitants of Jerusalem and of the land of Israel, they shall eat their bread with anxiety and drink their water with consternation, that her land may be desolate from all that is in it because of the violence of all them that dwell in it. And the cities that are inhabited shall be laid waste, and the land shall be desolate, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, what is that proverb that ye have in the land of Israel, saying, The days are prolonged, and every vision faileth? Tell them, therefore, thus saith the Lord God, I will make this proverb to cease, and they shall no more use it as a proverb in Israel. But say unto them, The days are at hand, and the effect of every vision. For there shall no more be any vain vision nor flattering divination within the house of Israel. For I am the Lord, and I will speak, and the word that I shall speak shall come to pass, and it shall be no more prolonged. For in your days, O rebellious house, will I say the word, and will perform it, saith the Lord to God. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, behold, they of the house of Israel say, The vision that he seeth is for many days to come, and he prophesieth of times that are far off. Therefore say unto them, Thus saith the Lord God, There shall none of my words be prolonged any more, but the word which I have spoken shall be done, saith the Lord. Now, what this is dealing with here is a frightening argument, because it's frightening in the sense you and I are vulnerable to it. And that's the argument that because, it doesn't get expressed this way, but the net of the argument is that because the Lord is really not going to fulfill this very soon, it's so far off that we're not affected. Now, in the practical sense, we see that in our lives, in our people's lives, where they figure, well, if God's going to do it, it's not in our lifetime, it's going to be future, so who cares? And that suddenly gets turned around to that because he's delayed so long, it really isn't true. They don't deny it overtly, but they sort of spiritualize it away, or they allegorize it, or whatever. Those are all mechanisms by which one tries, at least intellectually or some way, to get out from under the scope of some prophecy. Well, Jesus Christ isn't coming soon. I mean, those nuts that always say that are just, they're always saying Jesus is around the corner. Look at it. It hasn't happened, i.e., therefore it isn't going to happen soon, therefore it isn't really going to happen. You see what I'm saying? Now, this, in Ecclesiastes 8:11 and Amos 6:3, there are Old Testament examples of this, but I'd like us to look at a few other places. Let's turn to Matthew 24:48, just to see if this kind of concern that Ezekiel comments on for 2,500 years ago has a more contemporary application. Matthew 24:48 is the key verse. But and if that evil servant shall say in his heart, My Lord delayeth his coming. Remember the parables. This is in all the four Gospels, but I just picked it here from Matthew 24. The argument that the Lord delays his coming and shall begin to smite his fellow servants and eat and drink with the drunkards. The Lord of the servants shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites, and there shall be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Also, we have the same idea here in the following parable in chapter 25, verse 5. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And we could go on and on. There's many, many admonitions that the Lord himself gives us in which we are advised to watch and pray and so forth. That you enter not into temptation and so forth, to be alert, to watch. But perhaps the most telling one of these kinds of things, you all recall the parable of the servant and so forth, where the evil, the Lord delayeth his coming. You know, that's one reason, by the way, and I'm not being cute here, although some of you may chuckle when I say this, that's one reason I'm not post-tribulational. Because I don't want to be in a position of saying that the Lord has to delay his coming. If I'm post-tribulational and the rapture hasn't happened yet, I've got 7 years to wait for the second coming of Jesus Christ. A mutual friend of ours, Walter Martin, was a student of Donald Gray Barnhouse. And they used to have a funny, fun running battle all the time. Walter tells us of this because Walter is post-tribulational in some of his viewpoints. But Donald Gray Barnhouse, who's an incredible author, one of my favorite authors, by the way, was obviously very pre-tribulational. But he used to come into the office and he used to say to Walter, sad day, Jesus Christ can't come today. And what he was needling about was, if you're post-tribulational, you have a tough time arguing that Jesus Christ could come today. Because there's 7 years that have to sort of somehow get in your little charts, you see. And so that's one of the things. Now, on the one hand, I don't want to oversell this idea, but I do get uncomfortable about having to take a position which says the Lord delays his coming. The Lord tends to be kind of harsh with people who take that view. It's clear that Jesus Christ wanted us to be in a position of expectation moment by moment. And he wanted that for a number of reasons. And some of them are quite complicated theologically. Some of them are quite practical. You and I tend to stay a little closer by him if he could drop in on us any time. You perform a little better at your job if your supervisor has a habit of dropping by at random intervals. If he makes a swing through the plant a couple times a day, you tend to be a little sharper at your work than if he drops by every third Wednesday, predictably at 1:35. There's some practical implications. There's some theological implications that go beyond our scope here. But let me show you one of the wildest passages of this kind of thing, and that's in 2 Peter. 2 Peter, the second letter Peter wrote in chapter 3, and I'm really after, frankly, verses 3 and 4, but let's start with verse 1 to get the tone of the letter here. Peter says in chapter 3, verse 1, this second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, in both of which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance, that ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets, and of the commandment of us, the apostles of our Lord and Savior, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. And for this they are willingly ignorant that by the word of God the heavens were of old and standing, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water. And he goes on and talks about the flood and some other things. Getting back here, though, is interesting. Knowing this first, that there shall come when? In the last day. Now, that is just because there's scoffers walking after their own lusts doesn't necessarily mean they're in the last days, but clearly they will be there up to the last days. Now, these particular scoffers are motivated by what? That they can walk in their own lusts. Okay? And what is their position? Where is the promise of his coming? Now, the first point about these scoffers is they are scoffing at what? Prophecy. These scoffers are walking after their own lusts saying, where's the promise of his coming? I mean, are you serious? Now, there's several ways to deny a truth. One way is to say God didn't say that. Another way is to say, well, that's not what he meant. I mean, he didn't mean literally, you know. He meant it spiritually or some fuzzy, soft ways that is defined away of any tangible reality. You find that kind of scoffing going on, too. It's called liberalism, modernism. But the point is, where is the promise of his coming? So first of all, there's an expression of skepticism about what? The second coming of Jesus Christ, right? First point Peter's making is that in the end days, there will be scoffers walking after him and saying, where is the promise of his coming? Now, that's no surprise so far. It should not surprise us that at a time when there is the word going out that the Lord is ready to return, we shouldn't be surprised that there are scoffers walking after him and saying, come on, guys. Where's the promise of his coming? I mean, get serious. But I want you to notice what else they say. Where's the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. That's strange King James language for an expression of evolution. And the subsequent part of the text goes into Genesis and talks about Genesis and the flood and other things. You with me? Now, one of the things that's not obvious at first is why is there any link at all between prophecy and the concept of the creation in Genesis? Why is it that this issue of the creation in Genesis is so important? I mean, can't we have some kind, isn't evolution maybe the way God used to create? Well, that's not what Genesis says, and that's not the issue. Why? What is the issue that links these two? The concept that God intervenes in man's history. That man's history just didn't happen by the random events of the cosmos and he happened along. God created man. And the concept of God creating man is consistent and part and parcel of a concept that God will also intervene in man's history. That there will be political conflicts of an orchestrated kind, that God is going to intervene in that God is going to return to the planet Earth in power and glory to claim what is His. The whole concept that there is an Almighty God who put you and I here for a purpose, that in a sense intervened in the universe in the first place to create man, and secondly will intervene in the affairs of men to assert himself, express himself, and to ordain his way, is, see, the two ideas are strangely linked. They're not obvious. You know, why has the evolution got to do with prophecy? What it has to do in both cases is to express the reality that God cares, that he's involved, that you're not here as an accident of some protoplasm that has evolved through many generations. That is utterly preposterous. Now, I'm going to offend many of you here, and many who may be listening to this tape, but I'm going to argue to you that a position on evolution is intellectually undefendable. Intellectually undefendable. And let me give you an example of what I mean. I have a watch on my wrist, and I told you that this digital watch was designed by a dozen engineers working for 2 years to program the microcircuits and all this stuff. And then they built this and they sold it to a wholesaler who sold it to a jeweler who I bought it from, you'd believe me. But if I said to you in earnestness, looking right in the eye, that wasn't what happened at all. That's a cover story. What really happened was there were random bits of elements scattered through the universe. And cosmic winds brought these around to form certain kinds of atoms, some silicon atoms, some glass atoms, some gold atoms. And if these atoms happen to fall into a place of some, 30,000 transistors per chip, three or four of these chips, and it also formed little keyboards and little digital numbers, and by the way, this all came together and keeps perfect time ever since. You know, as I go on with that story, you're chuckling because it's ridiculous, right? You cannot conceive of this watch coming to existence without the intervention of a designer skillfully expressing himself. This watch is vastly more simple than the hand upon which it rests. With fingers and opposing thumb, the ability to grab and create and do. The engineering miracle of the hand is more complex than the watch. Yet you can't, and how can you accept the existence of a hand without an architect if you can't accept the watch without a designer? You've got a problem there. You can go at it another way. And you can go at it just brute statistics. If you want to take evolutionary hypotheses and take them and ascribe them to chance, you discover that it's possible through combinatorial mathematics to ascribe probabilities to things and concatenate those probabilities by conditional probabilities to come up with the likelihood of something happen. You know, you all know how to calculate, you roll a single die with the probability of a certain number coming up. If you've got six sides of the guy, you get one chance in six, if it's a fair die, of a certain surface coming up. If you have two die, you can combine that to get the probability of any particular combination. And those of you that play games are familiar with those numbers. Now, nobody in this audience, but somebody listening to the tape might be. It turns out, our scientists tell us, that a DNA molecule can be ascertained randomly by switching theory. And you get numbers like 10 to the 157th power to have a certain DNA molecule occur by chance. And we glibly talk about these kinds of numbers. And so if you say, gee, if you got requirements for certain events to occur by accident rather than design that become 10 to the 100th power or this, that, or the other thing, those are enormously large numbers. Let me explain how large. Most scientists would age the universe at something like 6 billion years long. 6, 10, pick a number. Okay. What is the shortest lifetime your imagination can conceive of? You know, we think of a generation in our life. Don't say being 40 years nominally. You might say certain bacteria have a mean generation of maybe seconds, minutes, hours, whatever. I'm not going to get into the biology of it. But the shorter the lifetime, the more generations you could have during a certain history. What's the shortest average lifetime in the history of the universe? I'm going to suggest if I told you it was 1 second average over 6 billion years, you'd be impressed. That's pretty short, right? There's only 1 second. There's only 10 to the 17th seconds in the history of the universe. Work out the arithmetic. There's only 10 to the 17th seconds. You say, well, that may be a little long. Maybe some of the early generations of these microbes were very, very short. Let's assume they were microseconds. They lived for a millionth of a second. That's 10 to the minus 6. So now you're talking 10 to the 25th millionth of a second? Get serious. It should be 10 to the 23rd, I guess it is, isn't it? It's 10 to the 17th. Work out the arithmetic. You'll discover that if you're willing to take a nanosecond, a billionth of a second, you're still talking, you know, 10 to, I think it was, 10 to the 25th. Yeah, go through the arithmetic. It's not convincing until you go through the arithmetic. The point is, if you concede the proposition of the evolutionists, that mathematically there isn't time, it also violates the second law of thermodynamics, the whole entropy laws, because things go to randomness, not order. And so you can go on and on and on. It is mathematically, scientifically undefendable. Well, if that's the case, why do people adhere to these ideas? Why do bright, deep-thinking intellectuals embrace the notions which exclude the concept of creation? It tells you right here in 2 Peter. They're scoffers working after their own lusts. That may be a harsh thing to say, but to acknowledge creation requires the acknowledgement of a creator. To acknowledge a creator implies responsibility. And how easy it is to delude ourselves by putting them out of our mind, by arguing, embracing these notions, which give us an intellectual excuse to deny the existence of a creator, a designer, and so forth. Now, I'm sure you may think I've gotten off the path, but I haven't. I haven't. Because this concept of denying the creator is just a close cousin, as Peter points out, to the denying of a judgment coming. You know, we sometimes can get sort of comfortable, if we're young, about the concept of judgment after death, because death seems remote, intellectually far away. Now, if death is closer to us because of age or an infirmity or some other threat, then suddenly these issues of, gee, is there a life after? Is God going to call us into an account? Become a little less academic, okay? But this whole, when you have a prophet like Ezekiel running around saying that God is going to bring a judgment, it's not surprising that they don't want to hear that, because that implies accountability. The need for repentance implies that you've got a decision to make and that your outcome is a function of your response to that creator. And I was going to say use the term obedience, but people get confused about obedience. They think that has to do with keeping laws, in contrast to simply listening and committing to him. And so that's whether you're talking as Peter did here, linking prophecy, where's the promise of his coming? For all things continue as they always have, meaning evolution. Or whether you're talking about Ezekiel, talking about a judgment to his fellow citizens that are in Jerusalem. Or whether you're talking about Ezekiel, who in some chapters from now is going to be talking to you and I about a Soviet invasion of the Middle East, going after Israel. God is using the same voice, the same penman, the same priest-turned-prophet to talk to them 2,500 years ago, to talk to you and I in our lifetime as we read the LA Times, as we recognize the tens of thousands of tanks that are being moved in the Middle East, as we see the positioning of Ezekiel 38:9, getting ready to happen. I no longer have the comfort I did 10 years ago when I used to be able to go through Ezekiel 38 and point out, gee, as long as Iran is pro-West, relax. If airplanes are flying overhead, relax, they're ours. Iran isn't pro-West anymore, if you haven't noticed. And Ezekiel will get to that. But the point is, the same relevance that Ezekiel had to his citizenry prior to the fall of Jerusalem, the sort of localized prophecies that we're going through now in chapters 12, 13, 14, That same relevance is to you and I when we get to chapters 34, 35, 36, 37, and of course 38 and 39. And you and I suffer the same risks if we hear and don't hear, or seeing don't perceive. And that's why I guess I got off the path here. Okay, yes, the whole issue here, of course, is this business of they're saying that, God is slow, he's delaying, he delays his coming, if you will, is his judgment. By the way, let's talk a little bit, one little other thing I want to throw at you here. We notice in chapter 1, the first two verses, Ezekiel started prophesying in which year of King Jehoiachin's captivity? Verse 2? Fifth year, right? We're going to discover by the time we get to chapter 33, verse 21, and it came to pass in the 12th year of our captivity in the 10th month, in the 5th day of the month, that one escaped out of Jerusalem, came to me saying, so where the city is smitten. Jerusalem falls, chapter 3, verse 33, verse 21. In what year of the captivity? Captives, but what year of the captivity did Jerusalem fall? 12th year. When did Ezekiel start prophesying about the fall of Jerusalem? In the 5th year. How many years did Ezekiel preach to them that Jerusalem was going to fall in the judgment? 7 years. Isn't that interesting? Those of you who are students of the book of Revelation might find that provocative. Those of you that have studied Daniel 70 weeks might find that provocative. How many, the 70 weeks being what, a week of years, 7 years? Kind of interesting, just a little toss away for you to sort of wrestle with. Okay, we're going to talk more about the false prophets, but you'll notice they're introduced here in terms of the lying and rebellious prophets. We introduced false prophets here. We're going to talk more about them. Those of you that want to dig into that whole issue of the false versus two prophets, you might study the contrast between Jeremiah and Hananiah in Jeremiah 28. I won't take the time tonight. Also, Deuteronomy 18:10 and 1 Samuel 6:2 and Ezekiel 21:21 is going to deal with this issue. We'll be getting into it more as we go.
Chuck will continue this study on the following tape in this series.